Hello and welcome to this week's Friday Forum Live with me, Sarah Glazer. As regular viewers will know, we broadcast most Fridays from Point Blank Studio here in East London to bring you exclusive tutorials, artist interviews, and the very latest industry insights. With Christmas almost upon us, we decided to embrace the festive season by asking the gifted and frolicsome Mr. Ski Oakenfull to deconstruct one of Yuletide's standout songs, Band-Aid's Do They Know It's Christmas. Luckily for us, he said, "All right." Hello. Joining me by the fireside today to deconstruct 80s Christmas classic Do They Know It's Christmas is Point Blank's very own Ski Oakenfull. Ski has worked with artists such as Jerry Negro, Incognito and The Bades and released on labels including Sony and Ministry of Sound. Two things before we get started. Firstly, remember you can find out more about our courses in London, Los Angeles and online by visiting our website pointblankmusicschool.com. And secondly, we are broadcasting to you 100% live. So write any questions you have in the comments and we'll answer them towards the end of the show. Ski, welcome to the Christmas cabin. You look fabulous. How are you?
Thank you very much. Well, yeah, I hope I don't look too much like a granddad.
No. Well, there's a reason why you're dressed.
There is a reason, yeah. Let's not give it away just yet. But there is a reason that I've got a really horrible Argyle tank top on. Yeah. So good to be here.
Cool.
Christmas, I can't believe it's Christmas again.
I know.
I think this is my fourth Christmas FFL.
I know, it's become a regular thing for you now.
It's a tradition, yeah.
It's an institution.
I know. But yeah, you know, I always think it's hard to choose which tunes to do. And,
yeah.
You know, because it's like, well, are there any actually kind of good Christmas tracks?
Oh, that's quite controversial. But yeah, there are some really dodgy ones
there
out
really are
there
some
when
bad
you
ones.
Look.
But actually, this one is one that I kind of grew up with,
yeah.
And I think it was last year or a couple of years ago, there was a documentary on TV about the making of it, and I just was enthralled. I couldn't believe it. I got so excited about it.
Yeah.
So I think, should we just kick off with a few facts?
Yeah, give us a little bit of background about the track.
These aren't really such so sort of fun facts, these, but...
hit me up with a not-so-fun fact.
Recording date, 25th of November, 1984. So we calculated that's 32 years?
Yeah. Quite long ago, yes.
And it was recorded at the legendary Psalm West Studios in Notting Hill, which was Trevor Horn's studio. Basically, he gave up the studio for them to record in.
Really kind, yeah.
Very kind. He couldn't make it, although I think he did. He was sort of milling around on the session, but... But yeah, legendary studio. Sadly, no more, but now he's got Psalm Village.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway, they were given 24 hours to record it, which is pretty tight.
Yeah.
Although... Actually, I think Midura had done a lot of the sort of the backing track at his studio.
A little bit of prep that had gone into it, you think?
Yeah, so basically the Psalm West was just used to actually record all the vocals and mix it down as well.
Mm-hmm.
It was then released on the 3rd of December, 1984, again, so a very, very quick turnaround.
Yeah.
I think it had several kind of re-releases as well. The engineer was Stuart Bruce, more on him later. Written by Bob Geldof, Midura. I mean, everyone knows that, don't they? But yeah, obviously, you know, a legendary track. And I mean, there were lots of singers on the track, but the key musicians are Phil Collins, John Taylor, Andy Taylor, and Midura. And he did all the keyboards and programming. So the two Duran Duran guys, brothers. You maybe can see in the picture, I don't know if you can see that, but you can see that Phil is wearing his Argyle Goldfield tank top.
Yeah, it looks a little bit familiar.
Polo, so it's a tribute to him. So yeah, there we go.
Merry Christmas to Phil, if you're watching.
I know, he's making a comeback as well.
Now, when Trevor Horn offered Bob Geldof and Midura the Psalm studio free of charge for 24 hours to record the charity single, but was unavailable to produce it himself, Stuart Bruce was approached to engineer and mix what became one of the biggest selling singles ever. Earlier in the week, Ski and I caught up with Stuart to find out more about what happened that day. Hi, Stuart. Thanks very much for joining us here at Point Blank to give us a bit of background information on this seminal track. Could we start off learning a little bit about the multi-track tape that you were given to work with on the day?
Yeah, well, Midge and his engineer turned up early in the morning. It would have been about 7 when we got in, and they had a 24-track tape with them. Most of the stuff was recorded already. All the keyboards, there was a guide drum part, And a few of the backing vocals as well. People like Sting had gone in and done a few backing vocals, I think, you know, while they were putting the track down originally.
Uh-huh. Bit of sneaky preparation.
Yeah, you know, I mean, it's always a good thing, really.
Had Midge done a guide vocal as well?
I have a vague memory of a guide vocal. Right. Some of it's a little bit furry, as it was a couple of years ago. But I do think there was a guide vocal, yeah.
Right, okay. And all the kind of keyboard parts and the drum track, that was all Midge, was it, as far as you're aware?
As far as I know, everything was Midge. He does tend to play pretty much everything.
Yeah.
So I think he'd programmed, you know, he'd programmed the drums, he'd put the synth down, and I don't remember there being any guitar on the track, but
so once you'd lined up, I presume you had another 24 track and they were synced up, so it was a 48 track session, was it?
Yeah, so we striped up another reel, stuck some time code on the original 24 track, got those synchronized, got those ready, and then just started to prepare the room, really.
So how did it compare to a normal day in the studio?
It's a bit like popping round to your grandma's for a cup of tea. And then the difference between that and having your entire extended family come round for a week.
But from what I understand, you didn't have that much extra help on the day, did you? It was just a few extra assistants.
I had two assistants. There was Hef Moraes and Steve Rees. They were my two assistants, and that was it. I could have done with another sort of three or four, really, but...
And how many people did you actually have coming in to record on that day?
To be honest, I don't know. There must have been about 40 artists that turned up.
Wow.
But there were extra people that turned up as well. I mean, for example, there was a great moment first thing in the morning, because the first singers arrived at 10 o'clock in the morning, which I remember rightly was Paul Young and Tony Hadley. And at the same time, Kool & the Gang turned up. Or at least three members of Kool & the Gang turned up. They were on tour. Someone had mentioned to them that this thing was happening. They happened to be in London that day. And somebody must have said to them, just come down. So they turned up. Which was quite... it was very comical. Because as soon as Tony and Paul saw JT from Kool & the Gang... They both looked at me and went, I don't really want to sing in front of him, he's really good. Which I thought was quite charming, really, considering that, you know, they were probably at that time far more successful as artists in the UK than Kool & the Gang were. Yeah. But Tony was very brave and actually went out and did the first vocal.
Any other gate crashes on the day?
Oh, I'm sure there were plenty, but I didn't actually, I didn't really get out of the control room very often to see what was going on downstairs. It was mayhem in the basement of the studio where the food was served and the lounge was and all those things. I mean, it was, you couldn't move. You couldn't move anywhere. I mean, because when we started to set it up, you know, we arrived early, we got the basics done with the tape machines and bits and pieces. And then, of course, we started to work on this idea that we were going to have to incorporate a few film crews because we were told there were a couple of film crews coming and they just kept arriving. Yeah. We ended up with 7 full film crews in the room.
Is that from around the world then? I mean, has it like people heard about it and come down to check it out?
In the control room, we had the guys from The Tube, mm-hmm. Which was great because they really understood the concept of a recording session. They really understood all the things that needed to be done and things that also needed not to be done.
Yeah.
And also they were set up right by the control room window looking out into the studio area. So they actually became my eyes because there were so many people in the control room, I couldn't see out of the window most of the time. And then there was a BBC crew, there was an ITV crew, and then just various other news organisations turned up. Plus, of course, there was all the paparazzi.
Yeah.
There must have been about 30 of them. And I mean, you can't control them. It's like herding cats. Fortunately, Jill Sinclair, who was the owner of the studio, she and her husband, she's Trevor Horn's wife. Jill's legendary for being rather scary when she needs when she needed to be, anyway. I always found her very charming, but she was quite a character. And at a certain point, I just asked her if she'd go out and do a bit of crowd control for me, which she did fantastically. She's an ex-school teacher, so, you know. Yeah. Yeah. So she was out there herding paparazzi.
Because I understand that some people looking at the video footage from the day might have thought that little bits of it were staged, but from what I understood speaking to you earlier is that actually that was all just what was really happening because there wasn't time to do any extra bits.
There was one staged bit. There was one staged moment where I think Gary Kemp was playing. You see a shot of Gary Kemp playing acoustic guitar.
Yeah.
Right.
And everybody kind of singing along. And that was just a moment when they did that for the cameras.
Yeah.
And the rest of the time, anytime you see someone standing in front of a U87 singing, that's a vocal take. We didn't have time. Yeah. There was no time.
John Taylor playing bass, that was real?
Yeah, but if I remember rightly, that was already recorded. I don't remember recording John. And perversely, John is actually a neighbour of mine now. Because I live in the West Country and he's got the manor house around the corner. I hasten to add, he has the manor house, I have the small cottage. But I haven't bumped into him for, oh God, eight years, because I don't see him locally. The last time I saw him was in a studio in London. He happened to pop in with Simon Le Bon for something else. And I saw him then. But I don't think I recorded him.
Really?
I think that was already done.
And were there any other bits of equipment that you were missing on the day? Like, I understand that you were maybe short of a few headphones for the recording the singers.
Well, no, just there were so many people to sing that there was no way that we were going to get 50 pairs of headphones out into the studio area.
Yeah.
Easily. Because the thing, you've got to appreciate the fact that on a normal recording day, like, for example, if you're recording an orchestra, because that room you could do orchestra, I've done orchestras in that room. You prep it up the night before. You set the chairs out, you set the headphones out, you test everything. We had no idea what was going to happen. You know, we just didn't know. And so it had to be done in a very rapid manner. And there were probably close to 100 people in the studio area all the time. Because of the paparazzi, the film crews, all these, and you know, the artists, various other people running around. So the idea of suddenly running out there with 50 pairs of headphones, I mean, that takes a finite amount of time to set up.
Yeah.
And then check. So we just shoved a pair of loudspeakers up the far end of the room, big old pair of tannoys that we used to use as studio playback speakers, and I just said, I'm going to play the track through those, sing along. And
well, it works.
Yeah, you get a bit of extra ambience on the track at the end, because the whole track obviously is going through this pair of speakers, and that's gone. That, you know, that spills into the recording. I was going to try the out of phase trick, you know, because you know if you do use loudspeakers when you're recording in that way, what you can do, as long as you've got a reasonably dead room, which that isn't, you can record without the singer, just the sound of the loudspeakers. And as long as you're not using compression on the vocal mic, you can phase reverse that against all the vocal takes and most of the spill disappears.
Yeah.
When you've got 100 people milling around a room, it's not going to happen. And we didn't have the time to even record the other take without the people in the room, because we'd never had a moment when there weren't any people in the room. So you know, it's just, that's how it worked. It's just the simplest solution.
Yeah. Well, I'd love to ask is there must have been a point when just all the recording was done, and did everyone just kind of disperse and go away and kind of leave you in the control room to actually concentrate on the mix, and actually how long did that mix take as well?
Well, I think the last vocalist that we recorded would have been Boy George, because he had taken, I think he took an earlier flight. He was on tour in Japan, and he'd actually taken an earlier flight back so he could get there. He arrived off a plane from Japan, from Tokyo, which in those days was a 17-hour flight. I know, because I've done it a few times myself. And that was about 10 o'clock at night when he arrived. And then he turned up at the studio by 11. He just jumped in a cab and came straight over. He was the only person that asked for anything all day.
Oh, what did he ask for?
He asked for some brandy because his throat was shot. Someone ran out and got a bottle of brandy, and he had a glass of brandy, and then he did his vocal. And that was the end of the recording. At which point I started mixing, and I mixed until probably about 5 or 6 o'clock in the morning.
Oh my gosh.
That was for the A side. Because of course we had to do the B side as well.
Yeah.
You know, because, you know, every single has an A and a, in those days, every single had an A and a B side. And the B side was the instrumental version of the track. With various Christmas Merry Christmas, Feed the World messages sent in by people who were on tour and couldn't get out of their tours. So people
David
like
Bowie was on there, wasn't he?
David Bowie, Paul McCartney, various other people. And also we'd been, Hef, who was one of my two assistants, he had a portable F1. You're all too young to know what an F1 recorder is. An F1 recorder is a very early portable digital recorder. The concept of portable being something that's about that big, weighs about 10 kilos, and records onto a Betamax tape. And he was wandering around downstairs with a microphone, just getting all the artists to say, Merry Christmas, Feed the World. Yeah, announce themselves and say, Merry Christmas, Feed the World. And then we took all of those and we spun them in onto, you know, they got stuck on a bit of quarter-inch tape, and then we just span them in onto the multi-track over the backing track, and that's the B-side. And that took us probably an hour and a half, just because we had to go through all those takes quickly and find the right bits. And you can imagine there was sort of, you know, I always remember there were about 10 takes of Bananarama laughing before we actually got them, before Hef actually managed to get them to say Merry Christmas. And there were certain lovely moments where there were certain artists who will remain nameless who were having to be prompted constantly to remind them what it was they were supposed to be saying. You'll have to wait and read my book in about 10 years' time to find out who they were.
Okay. Was everyone easy to work with on the day?
Everyone was great. I mean, it was amazing. It was an incredible moment.
I mean, I think the mix sounds great, and you know, you did a fantastic job. I was just wondering, like, listening back to it yourself, is there anything you would have changed, or you wish you'd had more time to
everything
to work on things?
Everything.
It's right. A mix, for God's sake. Of course I'd change everything.
Oh yeah, sorry. I forgot that.
I mean, in reality, no, because we had a deadline. It had to be finished by 8 o'clock in the morning. And it was finished by 8 o'clock in the morning. Bob took a quarter-inch tape and he went straight to Radio 1. Mm-hmm. I took the master tapes and I jumped in a taxi and I went up to Utopia Studios to do the mastering, because they'd given us a free mastering.
Great.
So I went up to see my very dear friend Steve Angel, and he cut the record. And I got stuck in traffic. So I was listening, we had Radio 1 on in the cab. And so I got to hear the track on the radio before I got to the mastering studio, which is certainly the only time that's happened in my life.
Yeah.
And so I listened to it on the radio very intently and went, oh, shit, I better change that. And I got, oh, God. So because by the time I arrived there, it was actually the very first time I'd worked with Steve Angel as well as a mastering engineer.
Yeah.
And I walked into the room with the master tape under one arm and Boy George's bottle of brandy in the other hand. And I was a little bit drunk by then, I think, because I think I had probably been drinking the brandy in the taxi.
It was just sleep deprivation.
We'd all like to claim that, wouldn't we? But it's not always true. And so, I sort of burst into this room and went, right, we got to make some changes. And Steve, being Steve, just was very calm. and we went through the track, and there are 7 compression and EQ changes on the cut.
Wow.
And Steve's a magician, because between the two of us, we managed to do them live. We didn't, you know, normally what you do, if you have to do a bunch of changes like that, you would make a production master, which would mean going down an analog generation, and then you would cut from the production master, because that's the safest way to do it.
Yeah.
But I don't like doing that, because you go down a generation, and I don't like the idea of going down a generation. It's one generation less quality. So we actually did all those moves live between the two of us.
Wow.
And I think it only took us 2 goes, and that was it. That was done. Then obviously off to the pressing plant, we cut a production master at the same time in case they needed to redo the plates, which I'm sure they did, because we did sell quite a lot of records. But that's how it was done. And I mean, it was remarkable that we managed to do it, really.
Yeah.
I think it's a great, it's just one of those moments when I think back onto it and think, well, you know, if someone suggested that you would do that, you just go, no, get off, you know, it's going to take 3 days.
Yeah.
But, you know, it's amazing what you can do with no sleep. And a bottle of brandy, of course.
Well, thank you so much for joining us, Stuart. It's been an absolute pleasure chatting to you and getting a bit more background info on the track. And we wish you the best
great,
of luck
thank
with
you.
All your future
that's
projects.
It's been a pleasure. Good to talk to you.
We'll be posting the full interview with Stuart Bruce very soon, so keep your eyes open for that. And also, get your questions into the comments, because we're going to pick one fortunate questioner to win Ski's ever-so-attractive tank top. And you know you want that. You want that. So get the questions into us. Okay, Ski, time for the deconstruction.
Time for the deconstruction. Okay, well, I'm going to sort of have a slightly different approach to the normal style, where I just put everything in, because there's quite a lot of sections here.
Yeah,
I think we'll probably be here all day. So I've actually done the deconstruction, and I'm going to go through, pick about six or seven sort of actual features, techniques that I've used
great,
to actually
yep.
do it. So, and just want to say that that's really just an excuse to show this.
I had to do,
always with these, I try and do a bit of research, and just to sort of find out what equipment was used, and, you know, you trying to glean stuff from the internet.
Yeah.
But I also found this, which is the first ever edition of Sound on Sound with none other than Midgeur on the cover. It's incredible.
Perfect.
£1.20, it says first issue there. Don't know how much it's worth, but but it's great because it's got the interview with Midge here, and it's also got an advert for the sequential Tom, which is the drum machine,
which came after
the drum rack, so the drum track. Mm. I think that was the drum machine that was used. So, there we go.
Lovely show and tell. Thank you.
Thank you very much. there's another one to come as well. So let's just quickly talk about the key signature.
Okay.
Always like talking about key signature, bring a bit of music theory into it.
Set in context.
Couldn't really be easier. We're in C major here.
Perfect.
All the white notes, so pretty easy. For the middle eight, it modulates, it goes to the relative minor, which is A minor.
Mm-hmm.
I've actually kind of got the chords up here. I won't go through the whole track, but just so that there's a reference. It's just really just using the 1, 4 and the 5 chord. So where the one chord would be the C major, the 4 chord would be the F major, and the 5 chord is the G major. And then it also goes to the 2 chord, which is a D minor. So we have the It's Christmas Time. There's no need to be afraid. I won't sing too much because I have this voice. But you can hear that, you know, it's very, 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 very simple. And then when it goes to the middle bit, it's like.
In our world of plenty.
Beautiful. Maybe we should do our own version of it.
The remix.
We can provide these chords as an upload afterwards.
Yeah, we can add them.
Exactly. So the next thing I want to talk about is the classic kind of drum sound at the front. It's like a sort of tom-tom sound.
Ooh.
And This is actually, I'm just going to get rid of, let me just get rid of the keyboard for the moment. There we go. Let's get back to this. There we go. So this is actually sampled. And it's sampled from the Tears for Fears album, The Hurting. And again, I have this album here. And actually, funnily enough, used this for the Push 2 demonstration I did. I actually took a sample from this as well. But they actually took a sample, mid-year took a sample. So I presume they didn't claim any rights for it because it's for charity.
Charitable donation.
For charity, yeah. Okay, so let's have a quick listen to that. There we go. So that's the track. So you can hear, it's that. So yeah, should we just have a listen to that? There we go. So yeah, there's the track. So I think we should recreate how that worked. So
yeah,
we should
actually. Look.
So I've got the Ableton project here, and let's just kind of a quick listen to what I've done here. So I've got put all the different sections into different scenes. So here we go. Here's the first section here, and this is the actual way that they've used it.
Yeah.
So let's just do that now. Show you what I did. So I've got a track here. And I'm just going to drag a simpler onto that. There we go. And here's the track here. I've just got this as an MP3.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm just going to drag that down onto the simpler there. And I can then shoot over to the push here. And let's just zoom in just to get the start point. There we go. There we go. And let's just zoom back out again and then just get the end point. Trying not to get my hand in front of the camera. That's always a criticism. Good, and let's just go to the start point again. All right, let's bring that back.
So you can cut all the delay and stuff off, yeah?
Yeah, exactly. Mm. Let's just bring this right there, so let's get rid of that second one there. Let's go back again here, zoom in a little bit more. It's quite sensitive, this. So there we go. So that's the original sound, and it's just playing it an octave down. And that's really just as simple as it is. It's amazing. Actually, before I found out that was the sample, I was trying to recreate it myself. And it was, I'll play you quickly what I came up with.
See how close you got.
It's not bad. And I was using a combination of EQ, I was using some chorus, some red arcs, compressor, simple delay, reverb, trying to get that. And then I found out it was from The Hurting. I was like, oh, right, okay, amazing. So anyway, that's the simplicity of that. So like I said before, I mentioned it earlier that Midyear actually did all the backing track himself beforehand. And he actually did a drum track for this, created just on a drum machine, which I think is the drum track. So let me just quickly go back to that. There we go, there's a picture of it. I'd love it if Midge could confirm this, but I'm pretty sure this was the machine that they used. He used. So let's just have a quick listen to that. Let's have a listen. There we go. There we go. So I've just got this. I've just found these samples, these drum track samples. Snare, kick, hat. Oh, no, the hat there, and the clap, and that sort of shaker sound. So, pretty kind of simple. But what really made the track was Phil Collins.
Yeah.
Because he came in.
That was amazing, those drums.
And he drummed over it.
Mm.
And what was great is I actually found some footage on the documentary they made of him actually playing it in the studio. It was actually him kind of, I think he's just warming up and then miking him up, getting everything together.
Yeah.
So let's have a listen to that. Here we go. Yeah. sounds amazing.
It does, really good.
I mean, a bass has been used as a breakbeat for a pop track.
Maybe it will now, there we go.
Heavy. I mean, he hits them hard.
Yeah.
Whacking. So what I was actually able to do was to add those in over the drum machine. So let's just show you what I've done here. I've done a bit of warping. There we go. So you can see that I've just looped that up, and I've just managed to kind of get it in time. If we just take the start point back, you can just hear. There we go, so I've managed to get that in time. And then if you put that over the drum machine.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's getting really juicy now.
It's really getting juicy. I think that what Phil just gave it that feel, you know, is a lot of kind of a swing in the
beat.
Yeah,
yeah.
So if we just unsolo everything now and just play that with all the other elements. Yeah, that really kind of gives it a lot of feel. Okay, so let's just keep going through. I'll play all the parts a bit later, okay?
But okay.
Another key feature of this track has got to be this, which is the
The
bell sound.
It's not a Christmas song without some kind of bell.
Exactly. Now, I just sort of instantly recognise this as being the DX7 tubular bells.
Right.
I own a DX7 as well, which I've just had fixed, actually, because I love it so much. And just need to keep using it. But what I'm actually using to recreate the sound is this fantastic plugin called Dext, which is not only a DX7 emulator, but also a librarian as well, and a patch editor.
Oh, great.
It's really good. So it's just opened up the kind of the world of DX7 again to me, because there's so many patches out there on the internet that you can load in. And actually what I've got here are the original factory presets, which was where you can find the tubular bell sound. So, I mean, let's have a listen. We've got the classic brass sound. We've got the marimba. Beautiful. I just love it, you know. But we've also got the tubular bell sound. So I kind of went through different sections, and a lot of the time what Midge is doing is actually playing in octaves. So let's just bring it up. So rather than just playing the one note, he's actually playing three notes together, two octaves apart.
It makes it a bit richer.
Exactly. So rather than having to kind of do that all the time, because it's quite hard to kind of playing it like that, I'm making use of this, which is the chord device. Which actually allows you to play one note and then add notes to it. So with that on, we've got the first one, which is up 12 semitones, and the second one, which is up 24 semitones. So that's actually three notes being played all together. But we get that great technique.
Can you set it as a sort of chorus thing as well? So you could set it for, like, if you wanted to use 1, 3, and 5, if you wanted to do that?
Or yeah, absolutely. Absolutely.
Yeah, so any combination that you want?
Any combination you want, yeah, exactly. Come on, well, let's just have a quick go of that, shall we? I mean, you can actually put it after this. So as well as having these octaves, you could actually have that then playing a minor third.
Great.
You could even make it.
So you can just keep layering it and laying it for.
You could do. You can go again.
This could get extreme.
Until the polyphony completely runs out. So it's pretty cool, isn't it? So there we have that. Now. What else have we got? Okay, we've got some, well, he used the PPG wave, and there's some, I'm trying to work out if some of these sounds, these kind of choir sounds, sample sounds, are coming from that, or they're coming from an emulator.
Right.
Again, Midge, please get in touch if you could let me know. Let me just play you this intro. There we go, so it's this really lovely kind of sound. And actually what I'm using for this is the great UVI workstation. It's the emulator 2, so I'm just assuming it is an emulator.
Okay.
You just get these lovely kind of breathy sounds.
Yeah, that's pretty close to it.
Yeah, so there's that. But then there's this sound, and this is just astonishing for me that they use this. So this is in the backing track.
This is quite a weird one. I mean, we were talking about this.
It's quite a weird one.
It's quite creepy by itself.
Yeah.
In the context of the track, it does actually fit.
Yeah, it does. I'm actually using another UVI one here, which is the DS77, which is the Yamaha SY77 emulator. And yeah, I just quickly play the part. It's using the pitch bend. So if we listen to it in context of this intro, I've actually got an acapella here. I couldn't get the original acapella, but I got one from Glee.
Okay.
Glee did a version, but it was five semitones higher, so I've pitched it down.
Done a quick transposition. Time. There's no need to be afraid.
This goes to the next section. So it kind of that part works in the context.
Yeah.
Again, there's some footage in the documentary where you can hear them actually tracking it, and that part is a lot more prominent. I think when they did the mix, so they kind of really mixed it down. They put it down in the mix. Cool. So that's out. Now let's go to the next section when the drums come in. Is this. And as we go from section to section, it's just chugging along in the background.
Yeah. Taking you on the sleigh ride, basically, isn't it?
Exactly, yeah. Well, it's totally going, it's also totally going along with this, the drum machine or the hi-hat pattern.
Yeah.
So that really is the feel of the whole track. So again, we can do this very easily in Ableton. So I've just got this sound. This is actually another sound from Dex. It's another DX7 sound. There's that sound. And what we can use for this is the arpeggiator, but not the actual standard Ableton arpeggiator device, but the Max for Live one.
Okay.
Because it just gives us a few more options. What it actually allows us to do is program in the pattern rather than it just being a kind of a constant 16th or 32 notes, whatever you want it to be. So the default setting is that. So the first thing we're going to do is just take the octave off, so it's just playing one note.
Okay.
And it's just even out the velocities here. We can also adjust the lengths. So you can see we can make it quite extreme. But that's really good, you know, and you can randomize these as well. But then all we need to do is just take off certain notes. So if we just take off these.
Sorted,
exactly. So actually really handy.
Yeah.
And it obviously syncs to the beat as well. So let's just quickly play along. Obviously you can kind of put any sound on that. So really, really great feature. So yeah, let's just move on. Now we've got this, which is it's like probably the kind of the most memorable parts of the track, which is this melody. Bring up the old keyboard again. I think this was from the PPG Wave. It sounds far too analog, really, to be a DX7 sound. So let's just quickly play it. It's actually a two-handed thing. So okay. So there's a nice kind of harmony going on in the left hand. So a brilliant part. And I just used the analog for this. This is the sound here. So we've got a square wave and a sine wave together. And the thing that gives it that really distinctive sound is the actual LFO to pitch. So if I just mute one of the oscillators.
It's almost like a weird string sample, like one of the really early string samples where they're doing the vibrato, but then it sounds a bit like a flute one as well, and they've mushed it together.
Exactly, very kind of warbly. So, I mean, it's literally just on like 0.06 at the moment. If I make it really extreme.
We've just gone into space.
I mean, it's what you control modulation with, so it's just that kind of vibrato effect. But it just works really, really well. And then with I've put that the same thing on the other oscillator. Okay. So you just get this. It's a great sound. They're the main bits. So I think, should we just have a listen through to the whole thing?
Yeah.
And let's just listen to it with the a cappella, shall we?
Well, unless you want to sing again.
We could sort of sing along. I tell you what I did do, which kind of helped when I was getting it together, was I just took the original.
Yeah.
And I just filtered off. I made it like sort of like radio EQ.
Uh-huh.
So it just means that. So it's kind of just going in the background. So let's just play through it, shall we?
Yeah.
Let's do it from here as well. And I tell you what we'll do as well is we'll just bring up the chords. So you can play along at home if you want.
Yeah.
So here we go. Here it is. It's my deconstruction of Band-Aids. Oh, you haven't done the cracker
yet? I was going to say, this is the Christmas cracker moment.
Okay,
here we go.
Woohoo! Are you one?
Oh, nice.
It's Christmas time. Have you got a favourite singer on this?
Maybe George Michael.
Oh!
Why, is that who you're going to go for?
He's got my favourite one, yeah.
It's getting quite special now.
Here we go, George.
Yeah.
I think we can make this project available afterwards.
I think we should do. Yeah. I think we can have a lot of fun with it.
Yeah, definitely. Wait, I'm sure about the end. There were like two newer versions of this.
Uh-huh.
I'm not sure about those. I think it always goes back to
the original and best.
Here's the middle bit. Really needed fill-in for this bit, so I'll call it.
Yeah, sadly he wasn't available.
Yeah.
Seamless.
Totally seamless. So there we go. There's the track. I mean, there are, you know, obviously kind of lots of different parts. There's some other synth parts as well, but I thought I'd just focus on the key ones.
Mm-hmm.
And I actually started doing a bit of remix.
Oh.
Yeah. I didn't get very far though, but do you want to have a quick listen to what I did?
Can we do a question first and then we'll do the remix? Because I'm very excited about that.
Okay.
But we have a question from Jason.
Yeah.
When using samples as you have, how do you check the phasing of the sample? Any recommendations? Oh, any recommended VST or processing?
There are some plugins, but for this one, I'll tell you what I did do for this actually is that it's very stereo and I monoed it. So if I just play that and then. There we go. Let's just play this. There you go. So you can see I'm using this utility here, mm-hmm. and I've just taken the width down to 20%. So obviously if the phasing, if there was anything that was out of phase, then you'd start kind of losing a lot of the body. So that's the original width. But that's down as a mono signal now, and it still sounds pretty tight. So yeah. Just using my ears really for that.
Yeah. Okay. Cool. Let's. Oh, there's another question for us. Andrew Kendall asks, on the analog synth, how come you used LFO for vibrato instead of a vibro controller?
I could have done that. Yeah. But it's just, it's kind of, I don't know, there's two different ways to use it.
Is it just personal preference, or is there a particular benefit to one over the other?
The benefit would be with the analog is that you've got the two oscillators controlled by two different LFOs. Mm-hmm. So obviously oscillator one is LFO one. So you could actually have sort of things, sort of different rates, LFO rates going on each one. So that would be, whereas if I'm right, let me just check. I could have used this vibrato here. And that would have been another way to do it. In fact, let's just try it out now. Let's just to see. So if I put this down to zero, and the other one down to zero as well, and then just turn this on. So yeah, that is a way of doing it, but I suppose it's just like I said, just so you can have two separate different rates going on for each oscillator.
Cool, okay. Hope that answered your question, Andrew. I reckon let's have a listen to this remix then.
Oh, we haven't got any vocals. Here we go, let's put the vocals in. I'm not sure. Yeah, maybe if we've got the original master tape, because we're going to run on a weird previous competition. So.
Yeah.
Yeah, have a word with me.
We'll have to do it.
But I just want to say, happy Christmas to everyone.
Yes, hopefully that's given you plenty of inspiration to make music over the holidays, and maybe even to get out there and collaborate, because you've seen how good a group effort can be. Remember, you can find out more about our courses in London, Los Angeles, and online by visiting our website, pointblankmusicschool.com. We'll be back in 2017 with more amazing editions of Friday Forum Live. And until then, we wish you all a very Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year. Thanks for watching, and goodbye.
Bye.